For latest updates, subscribe to our channel and press the bell icon.
The Custom Brokers Licensing Regulations 2018, like every regulation before it, lays down certain obligations that have to be followed by the licensed custom broker. The word used is obligation. Actually, they should have used the word mandatory actions. All the obligations that are listed down over there have to be mandatorily followed by the custom broker at every point in time when he is executing his work as a licensed custom broker.
A customs broker shall
A. obtain an authorization from each of the companies, firms or individuals by whom he is for the time being employed as a customs broker and produce such authorization whenever required by the Deputy Commissioner of Customs or Assistant Commissioner of Customs, as the case may be.
B. Transact business in the customs station either personally or through an authorized employee duly approved by the Deputy Commissioner of Customs or Assistant Commissioner of Customs, as the case may be.
C. Not represent a client in any matter to which the customs broker, as a former employee of the Central Board of Indirect Taxes and Customs, gave personal consideration, or as to the facts of which he gained knowledge, while in government service.
D. Advise his client to comply with the provisions of the Act, other allied acts and the rules and regulations thereof, and in case of non-compliance, shall bring the matter to the notice of the Deputy Commissioner of Customs or Assistant Commissioner of Customs, as the case may be.
A. Exercise due diligence to ascertain the correctness of any information which he imparts to a client with reference to any work related to clearance of cargo or baggage.
F. Not withhold information contained in any order, instruction or public notice relating to clearance of cargo or baggage issued by the customs authorities, as the case may be, from a client who is entitled to such information.
G. Promptly pay over to the government, when due, sums received for payment of any duty, tax or other debt or obligations owing to the government, and promptly account to his client for funds received for him from the government or received from him in excess of governmental or other charges payable in respect of cargo or baggage on behalf of the client.
H. Not procure or attempt to procure directly or indirectly information from the government records or other government sources of any kind to which access is not granted by the proper officer.
I. Not attempt to influence the conduct of any official of the customs station in any matter pending before such official or his subordinates by the use of threat, false accusation, duress or the offer of any special inducement or promise of advantage or by the bestowing of any gift or favor or other thing of value.
J. Not refuse access to, conceal, remove or destroy the whole or any part of any book, paper or other record relating to his transactions as a customs broker which is sought or may be sought by the principal commissioner of customs or commissioner of customs, as the case may be.
K. Maintain up-to-date records such as bill of entry, shipping bill, transshipment application, etc. All correspondence, other papers relating to his business as customs broker and accounts including financial transactions in an orderly and itemized manner as may be specified by the Principal Commissioner of Customs or Commissioner of Customs or the Deputy Commissioner of Customs or Assistant Commissioner of Customs, as the case may be.
L. Immediately report the loss of license granted to him to the Principal Commissioner of Customs or Commissioner of Customs, as the case may be.
M. Discharge his duties as a customs broker with utmost speed and efficiency and without any delay.
N. Verify correctness of importer-exporter code, IEC, number, Goods and Services Tax Identification Number, GSTIN, identity of his client and functioning of his client at the declared address by using reliable, independent, authentic documents, data or information.
O. And form any change of postal address, telephone number, email, etc., to the Deputy Commissioner of Customs or Assistant Commissioner of Customs, as the case may be, of all customs stations including the concerned Deputy Commissioner or Assistant Commissioner of the Commissionerate who has granted the license immediately within 2 days.
P. Maintain all records and accounts that are required to be maintained under these regulations and preserved for at least 5 years, and all such records and accounts shall be made available at any time for the inspection of officers authorized for this purpose, and
Q. Cooperate with the customs authorities and shall join investigations promptly in the event of an inquiry against them or their employees.
What are the basic care that one needs to take under the obligations? They would be, 1. Please ensure that you have a letter of authority for every clearance that you do. It is very clear under the Customs Act that one is not a custom broker for an importer or an exporter, but one is a custom broker for every consignment individually. Now the question comes up is that I am handling a particular importer or a particular exporter who gives me 100 documents a month. How do I collect 100 letters of authorities? There are two ways in which you can do it. So what can you do? One option is that you explain to your client that I will need 100 letters of authority. A second is, you could standardly print the letters of authority on their letterheads, take their signatures and fill in the details of every job over there. And the third is, you take a letter of authority from him for a period and ask your staff to ensure that a copy of every of those letters is put in the individual dockets that are made by your office for every clearance. The Federation of Freight Forwarders Associations in India and its constituent associations have come up with a standard letter of authority, and you should take that standard letter of authority from your clients. The FFAI has also come out with standard trading conditions. And it is in your interest as a custom broker to make your client sign the standard trading conditions, even if you are doing it once in a year, and saying that he is signing these for work being done with you, and he understands that this will remain standard for every clearance that you undertake on his behalf. The second thing is, because Indian customs says that you are a custom broker for every clearance, you must maintain the documents which are available to you, which are generated during the course of your clearance, till out of charge or late export order, and keep all those papers in a very neat and orderly form within your office. Which means that you must give a job number to every clearance that you undertake. There are no standard formats for giving job numbers, and you can create your own format depending on the volume of work that you are doing, depending on the locations that you are working in, depending on the type of clients that you are doing it. But you must have a system which you have developed to give a job number, and every document that you receive should go under that job only for which it was received by you. It is also equally important and necessary for you that for every communication you do with the client, you mention your job number, because your reference number has to be your job number, and your reference number cannot be exporter or importer's reference number. Another regulation says that you will store all these papers for 5 years. So it becomes very important whether you create individual files for every job,
whether you club the documents of number of jobs and file them in one box file, you bind them differently, you may decide whatever you want to do. But what is important is that every consignment, right from letter of authority till your bill, every paper related to that should be together in a neat and orderly manner and filed together. With so much amount of technology available and so much of the work moving on to the cloud, you can even maintain an e-docket. There is no way that the customer say that you cannot maintain an e-docket. It only says that you must hold a copy of each of the papers that you are dealing with. So when you write a communication to the client, please ensure that your job number is there. You write a communication to a custodian, you write a communication to customs, your reference number remains the job number. So please ensure that you give a job number, you maintain it in a neat and orderly manner, and you keep it. Another important regulation for you is you must give a quotation to the client. You may give a quote for a period. You may give a quote which is applicable continuously. But a quotation must exist between you and your client. And it has to be available to you for the next 5 years from the date of leo or out of charge. What has to be the format of the quotation? There are no standard formats prescribed. But it is very normal for a custom broker to say that my agency charge or my brokerage fees would be this much. I will charge you for documentation. I will charge you for e-sanchit. I will charge you so many items on extra actual basis, things like examination, unloading, etc., etc. Then I will also charge you on reimbursable basis the following items. While there are no standard formats for creating a quotation, you as an individual custom broker should have your standard format. Your standard format must have the type of clearance you are undertaking, whether it is a sea export, an air export, sea import or an air import, whether it's an inbound consignment, it's a home consumption consignment, whether it's an ex-bond consignment, whatever it may be, you must give those details. It should have a validity. It is in your interest that there is a validity. Because if you put in a validity, you have the opportunity to constantly revise it. You may revise it upwards, you may revise it downwards, you may retain the same quotation for the subsequent period. But you must have a quotation with a validity. A good way of doing it is issue every quotation with a validity till 31st of March of the next year. In April, do an exercise to revalidate all those quotations. You may maintain the same one. You may retain the same one. But you have an opportunity every year to look at your quotations. Your quotation must include payment terms. Your quotation must include the fact that GST would be charged. Your quotation must write that you will hold a lien over his documents or his cargo should he not settle your bills within a standard period of time. Your quotation should include that we are following the standard trading conditions as laid down by FFAI, and a copy can be provided on demand. So be careful over there on your quotations. It's a very integral and important part of your working. After the quotation, a linked obligation is the funds that we receive. One of the obligations is very clear over there, that the custom broker shall promptly pay over all dues received by him for payment of government dues. Now, in practice, what happens is that custom brokers are always afraid of asking for money. And importers and exporters in India do tend to take a lot of chances with custom brokers. So if you need 10,000, he will send you 8,000. You need a lakh of rupees, he will send you 90,000. And the Indian custom broker, instead of insisting on that 2,000 or 10,000, agrees to do the clearance and the client says, you send me the bill, I'll pay you the difference. In most cases, he does that also. So that is why it has become a set practice in India that custom brokers do tend to give credits to their clients. But once in a while, what happens is that that amount goes out of hand. Very typical example would be that you are handling a consignment for a client. He is going to give you 20 clearances in a certain period. In every clearance, he sends you 10,000, 11,000 less. And you also don't realize it or recognize it so easily. So it just continues, and then suddenly one fine day it dawns on you that, oh my God, I have to take a lakh of rupees from this particular client. So what do? Typically, you tell your accounts people that the next time the clearance comes, we will first deduct the 10th, our 1 lakh of rupees, and then use the rest of the money. Now, if your client were to just send you an advance, then you may be able to do it. But if your client is an import client and he's a clever client and he sends you the lakh of rupees and he writes on that note of his that out of this lakh of rupees, 99,000 rupees is for payment of customs duty, you cannot appropriate that money towards your outstandings because he has sent you the money by saying that this is government dues. So please be very careful. Across the country, I have seen that custom brokers tend to take this stand that when the amounts become excessive in terms of outstanding, they try to appropriate their dues out of future funds that are received. If the future funds are received without a note, you may still be able to do it. But if the future funds are received with a note that these are for custom duty purposes, you have no option but to pay the duties. Another obligation which you need to look at is that you will keep all your records in a neat and orderly manner, but read the clause very carefully. You will produce letter of authority only if asked for. You will produce the other documents only if asked for. Letter of authority can be asked to you by deputy commissioner or assistant commissioner, but clearance is done and then documents can be asked only by the proper officer, who is the commissioner of customs. So read the regulations very carefully, read the obligations very carefully, and understand that for every obligation, who is your proper officer. Then comes dealing with the client. What does it say over there? At some point in time, it says that your job is to advise your client to comply with the law. Another thing it says is you will make available every possible information to the client if it pertains to him. Then it says that you will inform the department in case your client is not compliant. So there are so many small obligations over there. Each of them is of great importance, but what happens to us in practice? In practice, clients don't ask us for advice. Now, here the law says that you will advise. Advice is always sought. Advice is never proactively given. So this play of words remains in the obligations to the detriment of the Indian custom broker. It is in your interest that please advise your clients through written communication. You come across a public notice, send it to him. You come across a notification, send it to him. You come across a standing order, you come across anything, just communicate it to the client, irrespective of whether it is applicable to him or it is not applicable to him. Let him tell you, don't communicate so much with me. And then retain that paper. If your client ever asks you not to examine a particular carton or not to open a particular container or to avoid showing a particular document, please be very careful. Worry about it. Why did he do this to me? There has to be some agenda, otherwise he will not talk to you on this basis. If your client comes and tells you at any point in time that are these clearances done at this custom station? Be careful. Clearances in India are governed by the Foreign Trade Policy. Clearances in India are governed by the Indian Customs Act. Clearances in India are governed by public notices and notifications issued by these two people. So there is no question of a custom officer telling you, bring this cargo here or don't bring this cargo here. There is no question of an importer or an exporter asking you, will you be able to clear this cargo for mine at this custom station? Worry about it. Those are worrisome areas for you. Real worrisome areas. So take care over there. The other obligation which comes up is, how will you transact business with customs? The obligations are very clear, that you will transact business either on your own or through an authorized representative approved by the proper officer. Which means that anybody from your office going to a custom area, whether it is the custom house, whether it is the CFS, whether it is the iCargo complex, for that matter, even whether he's going to a custom bonded warehouse, he should either be an H pass holder, G card holder, or an F card holder. It is noticed across the country that we do not, as Indian custom brokers, like our staff to sit for examinations and get G cards for themselves. While the G card is of the staff for life, it is in the interest of the custom broker that his staff have passed the examination. If any time somebody is found in the custom station, in the custom area, holding documents of your brokerage company or your client and he is not a card holder, you can get into very serious trouble. You may not want to take that staff on your rolls. You may want to try him out in cash for some time. There are lots of non-compliant practices going on. But it would be to the detriment of the custom broker. So this is an obligation you need to be very careful about. And you need to ensure that all your staff have their cards with them. They prominently display their cards. That is, they wear them around their neck or their waist, and are available with them at all points in time. Don't dilute this. You could get into very serious trouble. Then talking about information to be given to the client. The obligation is on the broker to verify that he is giving correct information. Now this again can get very complicated. So the best thing for you to do would be to take an extract of the tariff, of the notification, of whatever paper, and forward that to him and say that I am sending you the relevant papers and my interpretation is this. So you've given you correct information. Don't send a mail saying that this can be done without backing it with the relevant extract of either the DGFT's FTP or the Customs Act or the Tariff Act or a public notice or a circular or a standing order. It is your job to ensure that you give good, correct information. It also further says that you cannot withhold any information with you if that information is relevant to the importer or the exporter. Don't waste your time. Just create a desk in your office and just push out all the public notice and circulars which come to you, which you feel would be relevant. So even if you send 100 circulars and you missed out one or two, you can still take a safety net and say, sir, I've been doing it. I only might have missed that notification. So you can't hold me responsible if a particular notice or a particular information was not passed on. But if you're not doing it, you will get into a difficulty to explain why that obligation was not fulfilled or followed by you. Then you and your staff go to the customers. You want to know the details of the competition, you want to know the prices at which a particular import has happened, clients force you to find out names of suppliers. You know, clients really push the Indian custom broker to get a lot of information of their competition. And we succumb to it. Our staff have a habit of picking up other people's documents, noting it, taking photographs, making notes. You can't do it. If you are caught doing that, your license can be in very serious trouble. It's an obligation that you will not try directly or indirectly to procure any information from government records. The best thing to do would be to take the officer into confidence. Talk to him that, sir, I want this. Main le lu. Should I take it? Most of the times, I have seen that officers nod their head in agreement. If he has nodded his head in agreement, it means you've taken his permission. But be careful over there. Just don't do it on your own straight away. Then comes dealing with the officer himself. It's a very clear and wide obligation over there. You cannot influence him in any way. You cannot shout at him. You cannot fight with him. You cannot give him a gift. You cannot do a lot of things. It's a very clear obligation over there. Read this obligation. Exercise it with a lot of care, with a lot of discretion, with a lot of sensitivity to it. But what happens when an officer abuses your staff? When an officer misbehaves with you, then yes, you can tell him, sir, don't talk to me like this. My recommendation would be, if an officer abuses you or your staff, if an officer throws your file or misbehaves with your papers, please stop the work. Walk into the chamber of his superior, complain there and there. Do it publicly, loudly. We are here to respect the work. It is our bread and butter. We are respecting it, others cannot disrespect it. So this is one obligation where one needs to play it very carefully. One needs to be very discreet and one needs to do it in a manner that particular obligation cannot ever be used against the custom broker to show cause him for either a revocation or a suspension or a prohibition. Another interesting obligation on you is that you will cooperate with the department whenever any inquiry is done against you or your employees. We have lots of cases where custom brokers believe that I will not cooperate with the department on an inquiry against me or my client or my employee. You're not cooperating on an inquiry against you or your staff is a violation of your obligation. You're not cooperating on an inquiry against your client will lead to them charging you for abetment. That you deliberately are trying to help your customer, your client, do something wrong. So be very careful. Anytime there's an inquiry, anytime there's an expected inquiry, the recommendation is proactively go and cooperate. It is only when you proactively go and cooperate will they believe that you are not party to that entire misadventure. We've heard of so many cases where custom brokers get afraid when an inquiry is instituted against their clients. There is no need to fear. You need to fear only if you had participated in that wrongdoing. If you did not participate in that wrongdoing, whether it's the normal investigation, whether it's the preventive department, whether it is the DRI, the recommendation is prepare a set of all documents available with you, proactively go to the investigating officer, introduce yourself and hand it over to him. That will at least establish your credentials, establish the fact that you are not party to the whole thing and you are conscious of your obligations. Additionally, whenever the principal commissioner of customs or commissioner of customs makes a request for producing any documents related to a clearance handled by the custom broker, he has to produce it. He cannot destroy it. He cannot do anything negative to the records for the period of 5 years. In case of an eventuality that there is a flood and your records are damaged or destroyed, in case there is a fire, in case there is a building collapse, these are normal things which happen. But the minute something like that happens, it is in your interest as a custom broker to immediately attach a report of the police or the insurance company or the municipal corporation immediately write a letter to the Commissioner of Customs and inform him that this is what has happened. Another case which you need to be very careful is when there is a death of an F card holder. Now normally the F card holder would be a very important person in the organization. He might be the sole person who is holding the license. He would be the person whose death affects everybody. But even in those circumstances, it is the responsibility of the rest of the persons working in that organization to immediately intimate the Commissioner of Customs about the demise of the person. You must immediately stop using his digital signature, not do a single filing, because a dead man cannot take any actions. You're supposed to do that for G card holders also, you're supposed to do that for H card holders also, but death of an F card holder has to be dealt with a lot of speed. Another obligation, a very specific listed obligation, is that you will discharge your duties as a custom broker with utmost speed and efficiency. What it means is your client can take time, the department can take time, the custodian can take time, but you as a custom broker cannot take time. You have to work with a certain amount of speed and efficiency. When you look at the handling of cargo in custom area regulations which apply to the custodian, there is no such clause over there. When you look at the service rules and regulations of the custom officers, there is no such clause over there. This clause is only for the custom broker. So you must ensure that you work with a certain amount of speed and efficiency. Then comes the KYC. This is a very important factor. There has been a lot of debates, lot of discussions, lot of papers submitted, but the official stand of the Government of India is that every custom broker must know his client, he must know the person on whose behalf a shipping bill or a bill of entry is filed. But then they have defined it, and we need to be careful in reading the definition of the KYC. What are they saying is that you should verify certain documents of the importer or the exporter by an independent, reliable source. So you should go to the DGFT website and check up. You should download it. You can go to the income tax website and download it. You can make other inquiries. You can appoint a surveyor to go and take a photograph of the place of work if you cannot visit it. But it is in your interest as a custom broker that whenever you receive a new client who is not in your city, and whom you have not seen or met, at least do a telephonic discussion with him, do a video call with him, do a Skype call with him. Please ensure that KYC is your responsibility. The government has been very clear that the IEC number is for statistical purposes. It is only a statistical data, and hence our making a statement that, sir, if his IEC is wrong, it is your job to check, does not hold and will not hold in the event of an issue getting raised against a custom broker on KYC. Please read the clauses very carefully and please be guided by them very carefully. Then comes your staff. There is a very clear-cut know your staff concept in the custom broker licensing regulations. We all often make mistakes over there, especially when we are working in the port area. It's a very likely thing that one person comes from the village and along with he brings another 5-6 people, and by that reference we employ those people and they all work for us. And in that we forget that there is a KYS. You must ensure that you know your staff correctly. So collect all his details, verify them. If possible, do a residence verification. A very simple way of doing a residence verification is to send a letter by registered AD, not by courier, by registered AD. If it comes back as address unknown, address wrong, you know that the address is incorrect, And if it comes back in order, then you know that the details submitted to you were correct, and retain that acknowledgement in the file of your staff. Thereafter, there is another clause in the Custom Broker Licensing Regulations which says very clearly that you are responsible for every action of your staff. So be careful, be vigilant. We all want to work as, oh, I have a man, he's very trustworthy, I have not met him for the last 6 months, I talk to him on the phone, he does all the work. Please don't do that. Please don't do that. Make it a practice to meet your staff regularly. If you cannot meet your staff because it involves travel, it involves that, do video calls. Look at his face, look at his expressions, look at the clothes he's wearing, the phone he is using, the watch he is wearing. You know his salary. You know his CTC. If your staff spending is beyond the CTC that you are giving, you should worry about it. Don't get burdened that if I take action against a staff, he will leave me. What will I do? But such a staff can be more damaging to you and to your agency in the long run. We all want our people to grow. We are benevolent bosses. We want to be nice to them. But being nice to them and turning a blind eye are two very different things. And we should not be doing that. So be very careful as far as your staff is concerned. Maintain a good record of their Aadhaar card, their PAN card, their educational certificate, their residence proof. Know who are their family members. Know who are their relatives. Keep in touch with all of them. Be a person who knows his staff very well, because they are the people who are going to be your brand ambassadors. They will be talking to the clients. They will be talking to the vendors. They will be talking to the custodians. They will be talking to customs. You have limitations. You are not going to be in a position to do all of it. And they are going to talk on your behalf. It is very important that you spend time, energy and money in training your staff. It would be very myopic and narrow thinking to think that if I train my staff, he will leave me and go. Everyone has ambition. Everyone has a desire. Everyone wants to grow in life. If you can give that platform to your staff, there is no reason for your staff to leave you and go. If you cannot give that platform to your staff, let him go gracefully. If he wants to go, let him go gracefully. And look at training as an investment to the industry. Look at training as an investment to your enterprise. Don't look at training as an expenditure. Because the more the trained staff are available, less will be their desire to leave you and go. So think about staff training in a very positive manner. You will need to give them soft skill training. You will need to give them domain training. And most importantly, you will have to give them organizational training.
For detailed learning of all logistics subjects, visit www.logivader.com.